Hello and good evening, everyone. Welcome to our ICP Wednesdays, ICP workshop about crowdfunding do's and don'ts tonight. And we have three amazing speakers here tonight. And actually, we will start. Robin Schwartz is going to start the presentation of her project at Kickstarter. She's an amazing photographer. She's a teacher. She's also a curator and editor. And the last project that she presented via Aperture to Kickstarter and financed it this way, right, was named by Lightbox as one of the best fall books in 2014. So Robin is going to start, and she's going to be followed by Thomas. Thomas has run the Kickstarter campaign about the Lambs of Ludlow. It is not out yet, right? But it is coming out very soon, so it is happening and was successfully launched. Thomas is, again, also an amazing photographer. He comes from the School of Visual Arts. He's won awards and nominations, and his project, The Lambs of Ludlow, was featured twice by New York Times and also Aperture Foundation. And we'll be very curious to hear about his project after Robin speaks. And then we are going to end with Romke's presentation. Romke has not only run one, but multiple successful Kickstarter campaigns. He is an editor and publisher based in Brooklyn, and he's a founder of his own magazine platform, Mossless. And with his last issue, that is titled Issue 3, The United States, he has launched his second very successful Kickstarter campaign. So very excited to hear from the three speakers, and after they present the individual projects, and please keep the questions in mind that you can ask once we all sit down to talk about together the crowdfunding's do's and don'ts. Thank you very much.
This is the first time I've done this kind of talk. I'm used to just talking about my work, so I hope this is okay. Thank you for coming. I think it's a really busy night for photography, and I'm glad to be invited to this discussion. I can offer my experience to clarify my path in fundraising, and a friend of mine who I talked to just the other night, I have some information about her successful campaign. It was Lauren Fleischman, and she went a little bit of a different route. But I think each artist's experience is really different, given their own contacts and resourcefulness and support. My Kickstarter was created by Aperture, the historical photography not-for-profit publisher, and this was Aperture's second crowdfunding campaign. Aperture's first campaign was for Richard Rinaldi, and it was tremendously successful financially and with media profile. Aperture was asking $10,000 for Richard's campaign, and they earned over $80,000. And my book was to be the second launch, and I'm no Richard Rinaldi. His success was really intimidating. Richard brought to his Kickstarter his own contacts and his reputation as being a very successful collected photographer and a publisher in his own right. I was reminded that Aperture staff knew what they were doing, that they were pros, and that we were going to work together as a team. And that I needed to trust them. So I put my trust in very specific people and went with what they suggested, and they asked me if I was comfortable. Being with Aperture for me has been a little bit like being part of a family. So the second part with the Kickstarter, they had an update, and that's where the kangaroo came in. And my Kickstarter was in May, so it also coincided with Mother's Day. So my history with Aperture is that they knew me from my first book in 2008 called Amelia's World, edited by Tim Barber, part of a Tiny Vices five-book set. So the people at Aperture, they watched my daughter grow up. They had tolerated her rolling around the gallery on Heelys with sushi and soy sauce. And, you know, my husband's over there, and we were going to die, you know. Like, could you imagine it being in a gallery and having that happen? I guess if you have kids, you can. But I've also donated prints to Aperture to every benefit. So I had this relationship that was very back and forth. And so my Kickstarter with Aperture and their publishing me didn't happen in a vacuum. The Amelia World book, it sold out. And so Aperture knew who that book would appeal to, and I think that changed how, or really focused how they were going to do the Kickstarter. Financially, for the first book, I came to the table at Aperture, and I supplied the scans and the match prints, and that was $5,000, and that's all I had. But for the second book, I didn't have any money at all, and I badly wanted to be published by Aperture, and do this next larger, more comprehensive book, and so on the first book,
a thousand.
It was part of a small book set. But what happened with my work was that I had gotten a lot of publicity. I'd been asked to speak at National Geographic, I had gotten a lot of publicity. This is Oprah magazine. They actually ran the same image 5 years apart. So what I gather about publishers, and I think this is very hard to discuss, is that a lot of publishers ask you to bring $20,000 to the table. But photographers really don't like to talk about that. It's very hard to get that information. Only two friends of mine have discussed their financial situation, you know, about getting published. And one of them, he's tenured at a university, and his university is very supportive, and he raised money by collectors and his university. And the other one got the money from the publisher and hated the results and asked for the work to be reprinted. Having my photograph published by Aperture was a really big deal, and I wanted this book very much. And we discussed with the Kickstarter what rewards to offer, and I think they were really thinking about how Richard's campaign worked. The cover was Lorenzo the tiger. I'm out of sync with my images. And Amelia did a drawing for the Kickstarter. That was one of the rewards. She draws really well. She did a portrait of a chimp, and that was included in the appeal. I also think what helped with the publicity was that Gabriel Plunkett in New York Magazine compared my book to, she said it was kind of like Boyhood, except with pictures. There was a movie about 12 years of a boy growing up. So the goal was $15,000 because when they suggested that Aperture wanted to ask for $20,000, and I think I looked rather faint. And I asked them to go down with their goal because I didn't think that I would make it. But we made $15,000 in 3 days, and it topped over $30,000 by the end of that month. I know for me at Aperture that it wasn't a make or break thing. That if I didn't make it, they told me they still would have published it. That doing Kickstarters was, you know, a new thing for them. This is my friend who I told you about, did a book called The Lovers. And she's very soft-spoken, but very bold. And she was very proactive, and she contacted Kickstarter and told them, and she timed it for this book to coincide with Valentine's Day. And they did a Valentine's Day blast for this book, and she got her goal in 8 hours, which was sort of amazing, those blasts. And I thought that, you know, her sending out an email and like syncing it up with Valentine's Day was rather brilliant. She also is on assignment as a photographer for the New York Times and Time Magazine, and they featured her Kickstarter on their blogs, and she reached 26,000. One of the things that Aperture did was CBS News featured my work for Mother's Day. They went and photographed, and not only did they feature the book during the Kickstarter, but they also asked me, I was one of the people showing pictures of their mother and my story, which was sort of strange for me. And I had to write something up about my mother right away, and it was published. The thing about being published by certain places like CBS News or Slate or Lensblog is that the Kickstarters go not the Kickstarters, but the publicity goes viral, and they just like Petapixel just takes from other blogs and starts reblogging it, and that's sort of amazing. I had a hard time keeping up with that. So there were many, many blogs that reblogged my work. And I was very lucky that the publicist at Aperture was really on it and had good contacts. The pros to the Kickstarter was that it was really exciting to be, and I was surprised at the financial support that I got. I really, really didn't expect it. I think that, you know, I didn't have a lot of confidence in raising the funds, but Aperture did. And then PDN, after it was over, used my image for this article about, I think people were surprised that Aperture was doing the Kickstarter. So I'm very glad that I did the Kickstarter. The downside, there were a couple of downsides to doing the Kickstarter, and I'll just go through some images while I tell you about those. The downside was that so many people thought I was getting the money directly, and that was really, really strange for me, you know, because it ended up being like $30,000, and they would... When their books didn't come, they wrote to me at home, and I'd have to flip it to Aperture all the time, and I had to explain, and some of the people I really knew, and then a couple were, like, lost in the mail, and I was really the middleman with all this, but the most uncomfortable thing happened at my university. During the Kickstarter, I passed out, I'm a senator at a university, and I did a mailing and I passed out sheets about the Kickstarter. I was pretty excited about being published at Aperture, and I went up to the university president and I told her about it, and she said, she didn't seem very enthusiastic, but I got an email citing me for solicitation by the university, and I was, you know, sort of blown away. I thought it was like a really good thing. Here I'm getting published by a major publisher, and I got in trouble. I had to go to the union, and they explained to me that I had used the university server to solicit money, and I explained again it wasn't my money, it was research, I was published, and they told me it was just like selling Girl Scout cookies. And I wrote a formal apology to the president and to the university for sending out the email on the university server. So, but now they seem to like that I have the book. And to this day, I just went to a Halloween party the other night. I went to a doggy party. I hang out with all these animal people. And people think that I got the $30,000 and I published the book myself. And one of the things that's really important to me with my work is that I barter for my pictures. I never use professional models, and I don't pay anybody. I barter with photographs. And so to think that I was making this money, even though the cost of publishing a book, I think, was at least $50,000 for Aperture. Like, book publishing is very, very expensive. So this little monkey's named Amelia, same as my daughter. They're connected. One of the questions I was asked about talking here was whether I think crowdfunding is good for artists. I think it's excellent to do. I think that it raises you above the radar, and it levels the playing field in so many situations. You know, people with the support, with the funds, are able to do things that people like me can't. And I think crowdfunding is a good resource. A friend of mine is a folk singer, and he crowdsources. His name is Dean Friedman, and he crowdsources off of his website, and sometimes he uses Indiegogo. The aftermath of the Kickstarter for me was a lot more publicity, and the PDN article, and that the Kickstarter was successful. And I don't think that I would have had the same publicity for the book without the Kickstarter. So I'll just take you through some of the rest of the pictures. There are a few at the end that are after the book. Aperture chose what to use for public relations. Some of these aren't in. There's 75 pictures in the book, and I was pleased with the size. I thought they were really easy to deal with. This was my fourth book, and for my first book, I didn't have a say in anything, and I didn't fight for anything. It was a Norton book, and I felt lucky to be published. I think it's really hard to be published when you don't bring any money to the table. And for my second book, I fought for a couple of pictures. But it's very, very hard to fight when you don't have any leverage. My editor decided to make it, the book chronological, because it covers 13 years. Anyway, I'm very glad that I did it, and I think I'm lucky with Aperture, because they truly care about me, and they talk to me about, these things and really helped me. I've never had an experience with the two other publishers like this. I think it was pretty unique. It was important to me to be part of a community, and I'm very glad I did it. Thank you.
All right, so my name is Thomas Holton. I'm a photographer. I'm here to talk about my successful Kickstarter campaign for my book, The Lambs of Ludlow Street. Like Robin, is a 12-year project, which I'm still continuously doing right now. Was the Lambs last week. So what I'm going to talk about is why I think the campaign was successful. All right, I'm not going to show you the video. But parts of the reasons why I think it worked out. And one of the main reasons that I think when I asked about why I thought it worked is that the work was incredibly personal to me. And one of the things I would suggest is if you're about to launch a campaign, you hope to make money on your photo project, it's something really important to you. It's not a fly-by-night project, and I think that resonates with the people who look at these videos. One of the most important things I did was also to look at Kickstarter and looked at the projects that failed, and I wanted to see why. And there are lots of projects out there that don't make their goals. There's plenty that certainly do, but I wanted to go and see why certain ones didn't work. And I think what made mine successful is that it's very important to me. It's very important to the Lambs, who's the family I photographed for 12 years and continue to photograph them for 12 years. And that came across in the video. So I'll show you some pictures from the project. It is being published right now by Kärcher Verlag. Excuse my terrible German, Kärcher. It's a very good publisher in Germany. Actually, books are in the mail right now to me. It'll be published in Europe now and later in the United States in spring. Not too sure exactly why there's different seasons, but So I'll show you a little bit of a project. What I wanted to do was show you some of the pictures and talk about the project and let you know why I felt that the Kickstarter was successful. So briefly, I am half Chinese, and I've been living here in New York City all my life. And what I wanted to do was, when I started first photographing consistently, I didn't know it at the time, but what I started doing is I started always loading my camera with film and going down to Chinatown. I have relatives in Chinatown. My mom's from China. My grandparents lived in Chinatown. But I could not communicate with them, and they couldn't communicate with me. So we had a huge barrier between the two of us because I unfortunately don't speak Chinese. I grew up here in Manhattan, kind of attending this kind of schools here. And they were 70 years old, and they just came over from China during the Cultural Revolution, so they didn't really speak much English. So what ended up happening is I felt this disconnect with Chinatown. So I was always photographing, and I didn't know why, but I wanted to get behind closed doors eventually because most of the photographs that were taken were off the street. So a lot of those pictures are kind of everyday moments. Bok choy salesmen, fish markets, Ahmad Street. So what I really wanted to do was make something personal, uniquely mine. I'm a photography teacher like Robin. I tell my students all the time to make your work so uniquely yours that no one else could take it, right? And that's the way it's going to resonate with the viewer. If you take some, if you're making work that people have seen something similar to it, or it's kind of, you know, redundant from this other photographer's work, this has nothing to do perhaps with Kickstarter, but this is me. Maybe it would just kind of go over people's heads. But if you make something that's so uniquely yours that no one else could do it, I can't take those pictures of Amelia. There's just no way I could. So anyway, so I got behind closed doors eventually through a series of events, and I met the Lambs. This is the very, 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 very first day I met them. I was shooting black and white film at the time. Left to right is Franklin, Michael, and Cindy, about 5, 6, and 2 years old. So when I finally met the Lambs, this is a personal journey of mine. So when I finally met them, I decided this is what I wanted to do. This is what I've been looking for. So what I ended up doing was returning week after week after week for about 12 years at this point, constantly documenting their life. I go through pauses where I slow down a little bit. Sometimes you naturally have to let time go by for some things to happen. But this is the very early part. They live in a tiny, tiny apartment in Ludlow Street. Five of them at the time in about 350 square feet, maybe around this big right here, five of them. But what ended up happening is after they got used to me being there, I seemed to just become a fly on the wall or the kind of crazy uncle with a camera. So I got to document, see life with them, what their life was like. I was put on the list of people eligible to pick them up at their public school. I went on vacation with them. They kind of would come out to my house for Halloween parties. They came to my wedding. So again, this is a Kickstarter talk. So what I wanted to talk about was this is incredibly important to me. And I think the people that know me personally and the people that I know in the photography world here in New York City through ICP, I worked here for 8 years and I went to School of Visual Arts and I'm continually try to be as active as I can. Knew that it was important to me. It was, like Yuli said, it was featured twice in the New York Times, gallery shows here and there, so people knew that it was important. And so I think that comes across in the Kickstarter video. As I got to know them better and better, they kind of relaxed. I was less interested in their small surroundings and their tiny apartment. I got to know them personally. I changed as a photographer too, so you'll see the work change. I was less interested in their small apartment and the lack of closet space, which was kind of superficial for me at the beginning. But what kind of drew me to the neighborhood and trying to understand what life was like in Chinatown. But then I got to know them personally. This is Stephen, the father. So this is the first part of the project. This ended in about 2005. And in 2010, I started photographing them again. And what was happening is, when I started, I still kept in touch with them. Even in the 5 years I wasn't photographing them, I regularly visited them. The parents broke up. The father moved out. He lost his job in the Great Recession, quote unquote, in 2008. Shirley was then decided to get a job as a home health technician. So this is her at the 100-year-old patient's house. So I started photographing him again because I felt that, you know what, this feels different. I wanted to make sure if I was going to photograph him again to tell a new story. Again, this is a Kickstarter thing, so I say this in my video. All right, if you watch the video, I talk about the journey that I went through getting to know them and them getting to know me. The children are a little bit older at this point. The big room that used to be one big communal bed, which was symbolic of the family unit, broke up and they started making bunk beds and erecting barriers between their beds. As you can see here is a sheet, and this is simply her waiting for dinner, while Michael, who at this point must have been maybe 14 or 15 years old, is doing his homework on the other side. So I saw this as a sign also of things kind of breaking apart. So again, it personally affected me. I started photographing it. I was seeing the father less and less on a regular basis. The mother was quite often always at the old lady's house cooking dinner. So that's where all the kids would go. And so I would regularly make phone calls maybe once or twice, once every month or so, be, hey, Stephen, I haven't seen you lately. The kids would go to where the mom is because the mom would cook dinner. How are you? Let me get together with you. So this picture to me was at the height of him breaking up with his wife. He had just probably moved back in, had lost his job. And so a lot of the pictures that you'll see in the book are of him alone. And again, you might just think it's a portrait of him alone, but it was really because he spent most of his time alone now because the family was kind of breaking up. This is at the patient's house. Again, the children would always be with the mother most likely most of the time because she would provide them with meals. And so they were going through some typical teenager things. He was a very shy boy. He's about 15 years old here, I think. He was in high school. So I guess he's going through the typical high school experience. But great kid, very smart, just kind of introverted, which is fine. This is Cindy on a beautiful July afternoon, indoors, playing with a phone. So there's the old lady in the back. She's actually still alive. She's now 105 years old. Still kicking. She's going a little bananas, but God bless her for still being alive. But I'm still hanging out with Cindy quite regularly, actually. The two boys are in college now. I hang out with her, actually, almost exclusively. It's pretty interesting to hang out with a 15-year-old girl that's not your child regularly. So finally, Stephen moves out. He moves into Jersey. Again, this has nothing to do with the Kickstarter as much as I talk about it in the Kickstarter. I would say include what I wanted to do in my video was show my face. I showed the photographs. I talked about why this family was important to me. I showed the location. I photographed the neighborhood. I did some filming down in Chinatown. I never really showed the lambs live in my video. I just showed the photographs. At the very end of the video, there's a portion of me knocking on the door. And just as the door opens, you see a glimpse of them. And that's kind of a neat little way to finish. So he moved into Jersey. So I would go out to New Jersey. I would go pick up the kids in my wife's car, drive them out to New Jersey. This was Cindy beautifully amazed at a walk-in closet. So this is a photograph called Should Have Gone to School. This is Franklin. He's a pretty big truant. So I began hanging out with them more and more. This is the third part of the project. This is Michael in his dorm room. I went to drive with a 15-year-old girl to visit her brother in college. I wanted this picture to be in the project. I wanted to photograph my experience with them, how their lives are progressing. So I felt that the need to kind of pull out of Ludlow Street and photograph where they were out now. And so I wrap up a little bit about why the video was successful. And here is the photograph of the book. Sorry that it's not available just yet. I have a series, I got 10 sent to me, and this is the cover. Carer, there it is right there, is the name of the publisher, and I went, this is something we could talk about in the panel discussion, I suppose, but once it was successful, I went to Germany this past August, which is really cool. It was really great experience working with Kara. I have a friend that did a book with Powerhouse that perhaps was like your first experience, where she was just happy to have a book published and she had no say in almost anything. I felt I was a very, very, very much equal partner with Kara. We Skyped all summer and traded PDFs back and forth about editing and sequence, and I had a couple of teachers of mine from SVA, well-known and well-respected historians and educators, write the essays. And then when I went out to August to Germany, I watched it come off the press, which was really cool. I don't know if I ever get to see that again, but I went on press and got to see the book come off one page at a time, which was kind of one signature at a time, which was a very interesting experience. Again, this is a Kickstarter talk. The main thing I would say is make the work, again, I can't stress it as much as I can, make it personal. I think it resonated with not only the people in my community, the photography community I know, but Kickstarter featured it here and there. People threw it around the internet and posted it here, posted it there. I got emails from people I never met before buying the book, Chinese Americans who grew up here in the city. Your pictures reminded me so much of my childhood. Here, good luck. They gave some money, and so I don't think that would happen if it was a photography project on something that's not so intimate or personal, all right? So that was one of the best highlights of the Kickstarter campaign, was seeing people come out of the woodwork I never even heard of, telling me how much they liked the work and supporting it, and telling me how much it resonated with their childhood, because perhaps they grew up in Flushing or grew up in Hong Kong and now live here. And I think that came across in the video again, because I tried to make it as personal as possible.
First of all, thank you to Uli and Fabrice and ICP and everyone who made this possible. It's a real pleasure to be here. My name is Ramka. I'm the founder and creator behind Mossless. It's an independent photography publishing venture that's quite independent and experimental. We don't really stick to any model. I started it when I was quite young. I was still in high school, and I started a blog because I was looking at a lot of photography online and I really liked what I was seeing. I wanted to put out more. I soon started interviewing a photographer every 2 days. That went on for a couple of years. And in 2011, I finished the first issue of what would be the print magazine, which was a box with four books in it, and I raised $4,000 on Kickstarter for that. I've kind of grown organically. I've never really advertised anywhere. I like kind of keeping that to my own network and just kind of letting it grow organically. That's the way I like to do it. Because for me, it's just about the process of making books and processing photography and kind of recontextualizing things. But let me just get to what you're seeing here. This is the first video we made for issue 3, which was our third major book. We do make small books on the side, small handmade books. Who you see here is Grace. She was my partner at the time, and we made our books together. She came on board after issue 1. So around this time, I had recently graduated from college about a year before, and I was in a couple of internships. I had already been doing a lot with photography, and the internships weren't really giving me a lot of work experience. Neither were they giving me a lot of, they weren't really helping my career. I was not getting paid, and that wasn't really working out for me. So I quit. I had actually, throughout this time, throughout all the blogging and the making books, I look online at photography a lot, and I like to categorize things. I like to kind of, if I like something, I'll put it in a folder. And one of the largest folders was a folder on America. All themes, whether they're microcosmic or broader or on the road, that have to do in some way with America. And there was a certain point where it just was so big, and I was so fed up with my internships that I thought, well, I might as well just not get paid to do this. So I spent with Grace around 3/4 of a year, trying to find a sequence for these photos, or finalizing our choices. We had a collection of over 600 or 700 photographs by over 100 photographers that we thought were good, and so once we kind of settled on them, we sent an email out to all the photographers asking them for permissions and all the files. And, you know, was a very difficult process, but I think it was a really necessary one. We went about it in a really smart way, I think, that was like personable, but also very systematic, so that we could, you know, reach these this 100 plus photographer base in a really efficient way. This was the first video we made, and then we launched this along with the Kickstarter. And what you're seeing here is the dummy of the book, which was over 300 pages, and was kind of the first, the first finished draft. And, you know, this is like our final draft. And we printed this out on our inkjet printer at home, and got it bound in Chinatown. And we did a whole flip through of the whole thing, exposing every single thing in the book. Obviously, you know, you have to spend time with the details to really see the nuance of the pages, because there's a lot in the sequences. Just to give you an idea of what the book is, there's a lot of features with photographers. There was just one with Terry Evans doing the North Dakota oil boom. But a lot of it is just kind of montages of different photographers. And the idea is that you get a journey of America through a bunch of different terrain types and themes. So it's not grouped by state, it's not grouped by photographer, it's grouped by kind of a state of mind or a geographical feeling. It starts off in the desert and ends in the city, and it meanders through a lot of different themes. And those themes are never really clearly defined, because that's not the point. The point is to kind of bring everything together into one seamless identity through the eyes of over 100 people. So we spent a long time formulating our Kickstarter. It is, you know, it's the one chance we had to make the project work, because if the Kickstarter was going to fail, we wouldn't have no money, and we would have spent all this time on nothing. So we wanted to make sure it worked. So not only did we make this whole book to prove that we could do it, that it wasn't just this fancy idea that we wanted you to give us money so that we could try out something fun. No, we are serious. We have it done. Just give us the money, and then we can give the book to you. So we wanted to prove that we were serious about this crazy idea. We did have a second video in which Grace and I introduce ourselves. We try to be charismatic. We talk about the project, all the ins and outs. We talked about our inspiration in making it, all the books that kind of inspired us. We talk about our background and about how the book will work. And we even made a third video, which was a kind of graphic, fun, kind of like a abstract way of showing the book off in a really kind of like fun way, that kind of announced that it's just a week left. We only finished it 2 days before the finish, so it didn't really have too much of an impact, but it was still worth doing it. And I think having these kind of visual experiences, these videos, are really the backbone to having a successful Kickstarter. You have to have good information, you have to be personable in them, you have to prove that you are worth backing, you know, you want to connect with your audience. But beside that, we had also done a lot in terms of outreach online. You know, we're not a big institution. We don't have grant money. We don't take grant money. We do everything independently, and we're not associated with other organizations. So we had to kind of figure out ways to get the word out ourselves. So one thing that we did was we got in touch with Vice, and we did a weekly column of interviews with photographers from this book. Now, there's over 100, so that is actually quite easy. And we used to do online interviews, so it keyed in exactly with what we used to do. We did this, started just before launch, and going for about 5 months we did this, and it was incredibly beneficial to us. Actually, over half of our backers came from Vice, which was basically our saving grace. But we also made different packages of photos with unique photos from the book, that we sent out to different blogs. We said, hey, if you guys want to write about it, we can give you guys exclusive content, so it doesn't seem like you're just posting what other people are posting, but that it's unique and your readers might actually be grateful for it in some way. And that was really successful for us, too. We were able to get published online by Wired and PDN, and I think I was in the same article as Robin, I'm not sure, but that was later. So that all together really helped surge our outreach, and we got a whole bunch of new members to our audience just through that alone. And also the way that we structured our rewards, we didn't want to make it seem like it was a token or just a thank you or kind of an empty gesture. We wanted it to be structured like a really smart sale space. So you were motivated to pre-order the book there. But also the cheap things, the cheaper options were also kind of related to it. We made a small zine of books that photos that didn't make it in the book that we sold for $15. And the bonus to that is that we packaged a kind of bonus deal where you got the book and the zine would then only be $5, so you got a discount. So there, we had, by offering all these different options, we were able to create a lot of different competitive bundles, and that actually made people more willing to buy a bundle, like, you know, the larger package with everything included. We also had a print sale where photographers donated prints, and those went up. And we even had a limited edition books with unique covers that you could custom order. We had choices, and then it was first come, first serve. Those were quite expensive. However, those didn't sell really, really well. We did make some sales with that, both the prints and the limited editions. But I think the biggest benefit to it is it created an air of legitimacy. You know, we were trying to do something that was not just like an upgraded zine. We were trying to make a real book, and we wanted to prove that we were in it for real. So by offering these kind of more legitimate, high quality options, which weren't necessarily the thing that people really wanted, it at least showed that kind of attitude. And I do think that was successful. We used social media as effectively as possible. You know, we didn't want to be too obnoxious, but we did have to drive the conversation. One thing that we did was we direct messaged everyone on Twitter that we had. And I, you know, after doing so much with social media in the past, we do have, a notable following. Not an enormous one, but, you know, enough to get the ball rolling. And we had an email campaign, and we posted unique content to our social media feeds on an almost daily basis, but we didn't want to drown everyone out because I know that there's a lot of fatigue that an audience can often get from Kickstarters, depending on how it works. But, we also, after it was all said and done, we sold over 660 books through Kickstarter, which was a huge task on our shipping, which we actually hadn't factored in as effectively as we thought, or we had underestimated the price of international shipping, and we had underestimated how many international orders we'd get. We printed it at an edition of 2,500, and the price of the book is 45. We had a goal of $25,000, and we raised over $35,000. And part of the reason why it was expensive, is because we wanted to print it in the US. We printed it at Shapco, which is one of the best book printers here. They print a lot of museum catalogs. I've printed at different places in the past, including China, but I really didn't want to do that again, especially since it was a book about America. We wanted everything to be American, even the font is from an American font maker. But in the end, things turned out very positively. And I think that's about it. Yeah.
Well, thank you, everybody. Very interesting stories, very different stories. And I think we want to talk a little bit more maybe about the individual campaigns or what you kind of like took away from it in very precise ways. So one question that I would like to ask you for our audience, what would you say are your two or three takeaways that you didn't expect, but that you really thought made your campaign very successful?
Let me think. I touched on it before. One of the things I did do was looked at campaigns that failed. You know, it's an interesting kind of tactic. There's some really bad stuff out there that people are trying to get funded, random stuff. So I wanted to make sure obviously the work is incredibly personal to me, so that was a plus, I think. So one of the takeaways I say, also as a photo teacher, is if you're gonna really, really want to get this thing published and you feel there's an audience for it and it's important to you, you know, you've gotta make that come across in the video. Say why you think it needs to be a book. I've had shows before, I've had gallery shows before, they come up, they come down. You have 15 pictures, or they say maybe 17 pictures we could put in a gallery. The strength of the Lamb's work I knew was the long form narrative, and I knew it belonged in a book so that you could show, I only showed 53 pictures in my book because I don't want to repeat myself too much. So I mentioned that in the video, like the strength of this work. Yes, I've had shows and it's been out there. You can see it online. It's not the same as physically having a book. I love photo books. I collect photo books myself as a teacher, as an artist. They're great resources to have. You pull them off your shelf 5 years later, you can show up to somebody. Again, shows come and go. So I stress that a lot in the video, that this has to be a book. It's not this is not a campaign for a show or something. And it helped that Carer is a legitimate publisher. Your Aperture, Romke showed the book that he made. It's one of the things that you could show them that you're serious about this, because again, some of the Kickstarter things I've seen fail, were like, and it would be published as a book. And that's all they would say. And you're like, okay, where at Kinko's, you know? So if you're gonna spend this much money, you would wanna make sure that it's coming out, it's a beautiful book, it's a real publisher, there's gonna be a marketing campaign behind it. So that was one of the things I saw that failed. You know, and I was happily surprised by the number of friends that came out of the woodwork and gave me money. It was amazing. People I hadn't seen since college for 20 years would donate money. And then I was equally surprised that my best friend from college didn't give money, you know? So you just kind of like, you know, it's not personal. It is personal, okay, it's not, you know, I have a lot, most of my friends aren't artists. You know, most of my friends are just my friends from college and growing up here in the city, so a lot of them just don't get it. You know, a lot of them don't even get what I still do. I do this all the time, you know? I'm a photographer for the past 30 years, so.
So if we go to the question, so on the one hand, you would say that you really did a lot of research about why campaigns failed. Then you were very clear about the format and the result of the crowdfunding campaign. And you also really wanted to see it like as that book format.
Right, yeah? If you want to sum it up, yeah.
Apart from the fact that you are, in general, very serious about your work.
Of course.
And this conviction also is, right. that you really emphasized strongly in the video.
Yeah, and you also in the video and in the text in the video, not in the video, but the text itself, you know, I showed it to somebody and they recommended that you put this part first and maybe this part last, like in the order of the video, the words, because people have no attention span. So you want to, you know, the first paragraph or something to be why you think it should be a book. And then maybe towards the end, you talk about your biography or something like that.
So you would recommend to get some help of a video editor or somebody who at least has some experience in this field.
Well, I mean, I did it myself, but someone taught me how to do it.
We'll get to the video in a little bit. But Robin, what would you say are your two or three takeaways that you would highly recommend for someone who runs a Kickstarter campaign to think about and consider?
I think you have to use your existing resources, that you have to think about your contacts. You asked me a question about publishing. Aperture published 6,000 books, but also it was cross-published with Carrick. They did it in Germany, and I didn't really know much about it. You know, there were contracts involved, and I think that it can be really like walking a very tight line about what you fight for and what you go with the flow for if you want to be published by a certain publisher. Perhaps if you're dealing with another publisher, the one in Italy where you're bringing maybe $50,000 to the table, how much do you, I mean, it's interesting the amount of money that's involved. Perhaps if you're bringing more money to the table, you have more clout. I don't know, but I really went with the flow with a lot of things. I didn't look at other Kickstarters. I did feel obligated if someone contributed to my Kickstarter and then they emailed me about their Kickstarter. I ended up buying more books than I wanted to, but it was like, you know, I had no choice. It was a matter of respect and sort of decency.
Well, you also really strongly feel how great it is that somebody helped you.
Yeah, but I don't necessarily want everyone's book. It has $50 adds up. So I think that you have to use the relationships you have, that you're not starting from scratch, and hopefully support. You seem like to have a very good base of support from SVA. Mine was Aperture. I mean, I told you what happened at my university, which was quite bizarre for me. You know, it's pretty shocking. You know, I think they like to come around after you've done something. And but as I said, I have friends that have a tremendous support from their universities, and that's interesting to know what to tap into for resources and support.
And Romke, what about you?
Well, the bundling, like I mentioned before, was a surprise how successful it was. Like I said, we had a $15 zine, which I thought would be one of the most popular items since my audience is mostly young people. But we offered, as the book, like I mentioned, the book is $45. And we offered a $50 option where you get the book and the zine. Now, the $45 and the $50 were the two most popular items. They were kind of at the same level. And I was really surprised at that. I thought that it would be successful, but not like that. Beyond all others, those were the most successful. And that's kind of unique because as far as my research has told me, most Kickstarters, the average contribution is around $30, $25 to $35, which we didn't have a lot. I don't remember if we had anything in that range. Oh, we did have kind of a sale of old books that we had. We had a bundle of that as well. That was around that range. But again, the most popular one was the one that was just like the thing itself. And because we offered kind of clever and discounted options, it made people feel like what they were getting was actually their money's worth. And that really was more successful than I had anticipated. And another thing I took away from it, which I learned the hard way through both, is that you really have to meditate. You have to really take your time. You have to be calm. And you have to learn to sit with the stress, because it is so stressful to have a Kickstarter up. Well, you know, you have these dream Kickstarters that everything gets funded in the first 5 minutes. I don't think I'll ever be a part of one of those, unless I'm lucky. I don't know. Those are really rare. Most of the time, you don't think you'll get funded, period. Most contributions are made in the last few days of a Kickstarter's life. That's often the case, and that's been the case for me as well. Especially in the first one. And you just have to learn to be okay with that and letting yourself feel comfortable, because I've seen a lot of people kind of freak out halfway through, worried that they're not going to make it, and they start doing things that make them look bad, and it doesn't help the Kickstarter at all. That's something to be really wary of, and know that it's always the last week that matters the most. Yeah.
I'll have a little bit to say about that. But let's talk about the rewards a little bit, because I think that is definitely important for everybody to think about and to know about. And based on success rates, there are certain golden rules or standards for different categories. And I think, again, it would be interesting to kind of like hear, how did you deal with that? How many rewards did you have, for example, Romke? How many?
Well, because we had the print sale, each of the prints was an individual reward. So we ended up having over 20 reward options. We had around five hot ones, I'd say. Five ones that a lot of people chose. And the rest were kind of...
And what price ranges were they in? So you said your book sold for $50.
The book itself, the zine, the cutoff zine, the kind of like extra, that was 15.
Was 15,
the book
yeah.
itself was 45.
Okay.
And the book and zine was 50.
Okay.
And then we also had some other ones.
Is the book going to be available outside of the Kickstarter?
Yes.
Or only
same price.
Available and the for shipping, 45?
Yes,
or?
45. And the other thing was, we made for domestic, we made shipping free. Mm-hmm. So that was kind of, you know, if you pre-order it, not only do you get it when it comes out, but you also get the shipping free. So that was an added benefit. Mm-hmm. At first, we had it for all shipments, and then we realized, wait a minute, we can't do this for international. And we were kind of late on that, and that's how we kind of got screwed over in the end, and that we didn't have enough money for a lot of international shipments. The nice thing about shipping in the US is there's media mail, and media mail is a really nice discounted version of for shipping books. Now, if you're an established bookmaker, you usually go with FedEx or something because it's faster. But when you're independent, you go with media mail.
Did the photographers in the book buy the book?
No, I mean, everybody in the book got a free book.
That's amazing.
And we're actually paying them as well. Not much, but a nominal fee. That's a profit share.
You're amazing.
Thomas, how many rewards did you have?
I had, I had five, I do believe. Mm-hmm. The key thing was the book itself. Like Ramke said, the most popular, I did a little bit of research on Kickstarter, apparently the most popular numbers are $25 and $100. And that's what I found out by kind of dorking around, looking around at the Kickstarter website. So I had the book itself when it comes out in the United States. Because it's a European publication and it's coming out in Europe first, I use that as a way to kind of sell it for $100. You get it before everyone else. So that's what's in the mail actually like right now. So listen, hey, for $100, you get the same book, but you get it in November versus waiting till April or March. And that was very, very popular. And so it wasn't a limited edition thing or anything like that. And then once I started, at $300, you got the book and a print. And you had to choose carefully which prints you wanted. I've had gallery shows, so I kind of know that decorative things tend to do better than perhaps random, like a portrait. So I chose the pictures that tended to be prettier to go with like the $300
package. So your rewards went from what to what price point?
$10 was just a thank you in the book. It went from $10 to $1,500. And the most
what
common.
What was the most successful? The
$100, yeah, the $100 one, which would be the book for whatever it is, 4 or 5 months before everyone else. And an invitation to the party, which I'm planning right now, which is kind of cool.
Robin, do you want to say something to that also, or do you want to?
The rewards were two different size prints, so the tiger print, 8x10 and 16x20s. And my daughter did a drawing. Of a chimp's face, and that was part of the reward. Also, I still haven't done this. I'm going to shoot at people's houses, and one person lives in Michigan somewhere, and another one in Chicago, and the person in Chicago is going to fly me out. And so there are three people that bid on me to shoot. I don't know what. And they have me, and I have to figure out the one in Michigan how to get there. So that didn't seem that thought out, but I'll figure it out. I was teaching full time, so I wasn't as thorough as you were. I went with the flow, and I'm business is not my thing. So I really admire these guys because I don't know if I could have really pulled this off by myself.